We started this year preaching the power of team, and we certainly relied upon that here in our preparation and during the course of the game. And outlining how we thought the game would go and some of the things that would be really important was that be prepared to go the long haul in this game, that this game was going to be decided well into the game, very late in the game. We had emphasized that all along in our preparation, so I think that certainly helped see us through the rough start of the game. Just staying true to that mentality that this game was going to be decided late, just keep fighting it out. And then and the other thing that we had emphasized all week long was it was everybody's job in this game to find a way to win. And a lot of players had to step up individually and do that. Obviously, the heart and the energy, as well as the production that Marcus provided us, was just a tremendous punctuation point to the career that he's had at Virginia. He's been a special player for us, and the things he's been able to do, how he's energized his team. I can't imagine how a player could have greater heart or be more selfless and care more about his team than this kid has. He's been a tremendous figurehead for what we're trying to get out of everybody, and I just love him to death. Connor stepped up as he has throughout his career for us. A lot of times feel a little bit shaky there at the end when it's dependent on that, but I just asked him a little while ago, did he feel as calm about it as I did? And he just grinned. He said, "Coach, this was the easiest one I ever tried." And I think it's fitting for a kid who's had a career like he has to be able to do this at the end because he's been so important in so many games that we've won. Start trying to say all the guys who did a great job, invariably you leave some out, but certainly those two stand out. And then I think collectively what the defensive players were able to do here to be behind 21-7, and kind of looking like if things didn't get a little bit better, it might turn out to be 70. I thought they did a terrific job really bowing their backs up, particularly against the running game. I thought the quarterback from Minnesota was outstanding. We thought he was good coming in, and he's even better in person. We had practiced, made a big point of emphasis about what we refer to as hideout plays. That is, this is not a team that runs a lot of intricate, highly sophisticated patterns, but Minnesota does a terrific job with, through play action and other things, trying to lose receivers. And we'd put a big emphasis on that, and that was certainly discouraging to give up three scores that we did on those kind of plays. And but they were never deterred from it, and they kept going back and answering every challenge that was put in front of them. So we're very pleased and proud. We certainly appreciate the great following that we had here, and this has been a tremendously organized and well-conducted bowl game. I know it's, I think, only the eighth, isn't it, Dale? But I tell you, these people put this show on here like it was the 58th. They know what they're doing with this, and it's. I have something to tell John Swofford and the other people associated with the ACC. Is I'm sure they were pleased about the contract when they signed it, but they don't realize how pleased they should be because this will be a great contract for the Atlantic Coast Conference. So thank you, fellas. It was a great job.
Al, did you see the replay of the Hamilton interception?
I didn't see any replays.
Just off the top of your head, what do you think of this play down there?
It's one of those game-saving plays. You know, if you're going to win games like this, okay, your guy makes the play, you win. Their guy makes the play, they win. You know, you just have to step up and make those kind of plays. And that fell into the category of finding a way to win.
Last year, a guy who looks for interceptions, though.
Yeah, he looked a little too hard for one there in the first half. Okay, I mean where that ball.
That on the defensive court.
No. Okay, where that ball was caught was where he was supposed to be. Okay, well, he thought it'd be a little cute and jump that one, but you know that's what it is. That's we've talked. You guys have heard me talk about being resilient and taking a punch and coming back. And I just told him, look, one, hey, what's going on there? Two, I expect a lot more out of you than that.
Coach,
You know, if we're going to get plays like that from you, then what else is everybody going to do? I expect you to be one of the guys who leads us now. Do something in the game to prove that to be true. And he certainly did a wonderful job of that.
What your defense, after Marcus threw his interception, Minnesota has him on the 38, I believe. From that point, you know, your defense forces a 3-and-out to miss the plays. What happened, kind of the transformation of the defense in the second half? What was the defense doing then that they had not done?
Well, I think, as is the case in a lot of these bowl games, Jeff, you know, you have 11 games to look at. There's a ton of things that a team can do. We're in the same circumstance, and sometimes it takes a little while, a little bit longer maybe than when a team has an opportunity. Hey, we were the same way, you know, with our offense and defense. But when a team has an opportunity to center in on things and have multiple practices, sometimes it takes a little bit longer to kind of define the game. Whether it's matchups or schemes. And once we were able to kind of get the game defined, and we didn't have a lot of different changes. This is, I went and had a little piece of paper with the game plan written on it. This wasn't one of those high-tech printed out on your computer game plans. It's kind of retro football. But a lot of it had to do with the players getting a feel and a rhythm for the blocks and how to fit on the plays. And, you know, we did a couple things that were a little bit different that might have put them in a little bit sounder positions.
As your tight ends had a lot of open space down the middle of the field and kept going to that, something you saw coming into this game?
If you see us play over the last 5 years, you know we're pretty tight end oriented, so we're always looking for opportunities to get the ball there. And obviously we had an idea that we could get some, and Marcus did a great job of getting the ball to Tom in those spots. But we're always going to kind of be looking in those areas. It doesn't always come true, but when a team plays a lot of middle of the field open coverages, you know, in certain formations, if they play middle closed, then you go someplace else. If they play middle open, then you have the opportunity down the middle, and that's pretty much been our style. And he did a real good. Some of those balls that went out to the sidelines today, those are middle closed coverages. So Marcus did a real good job of making the right decision of where the soft spot in the coverage was.
Nice to see Sammy have a game like this in his hometown.
But it was a wonderful thing for him. Wonderful thing for him. You know, and he's done. We've asked a lot of them for a young player. I think, you know, player like Tom, in a few years from now, when we have a little bit more foundation underneath us, and maybe a player like that will have a chance to sit around and season. And he's been asked to come in and play a major role in a hurry, but he's a very mature kid. He takes coaching terrifically. In other words, when you point something out to him, he tries very quickly to do it. And it's great for him and his family.
It looked like Schmidt was at nose for a fair amount.
He was.
What about it seemed like Long and Red were particularly active.
Right.
Talk about the need for Red to get more production out.
Well, there was a point in the game, Jeff, where we were getting a lot of the ball cutting back into the bubble between the nose and the defensive ends of the side of the play. And, you know, Brennan, as I've said on other occasions during the course of the year, that Brennan probably was our best nose if we could have played him there more. But we had some significant bodies there, and we needed him at defensive end. But to try to solve that problem, that's why we put him in there on the nose, because this is a great player that anybody had to go against in there. So we wanted to see how it looked in the early going, and as it turned out, we better throw our best in there to go against their best. And I think that helped out in the middle a little bit. And then Chris and Vince really stepped up, and we were able to get the ball pushed to the edge a little bit more instead of having it cut back on us. They did a real good job of being able to hold the point as the game went on.
Now, the end of the first half was somewhat reminiscent of last year's bowl game where you scored the field goal when the team been marching down the field. Did you feel going into the locker room that the momentum may have shifted a little bit there at the end of the half?
Well, actually, it was the opposite of last year. Last year, they kicked it. It's certainly, I think the game, obviously the points were very important. You could say those were also the 3 points. You know, we emphasize a lot this beat the clock period of a game. And we got our two field goals both came in the final minute of each half. You take those away, if had we not been able to put a drive together at those points, then we would have been 6 points shy. And obviously we wouldn't be feeling quite as happy about things as we do right now. But again, a couple of those plays were, you know, Marcus Hagan's creations, and especially the one throw that he got the ball into the middle to Deion, we were able to get good field position on. We almost lost the field goal there. We get in that hurry-up situation. A lot of the calls are made on the field. In that particular one, he underestimated how much time or overestimated how much time we had left. And fortunately, I was close enough to the official that I was hoping he'd go down earlier. But, you know, with the new rule whereby the coach last year, where the coach can call timeout on the sideline, that enabled us to get the timeout called faster than if it had been called on the field.
Final question in the back.
What was the range of emotions like for you on the interception in the end zone, Minnesota's sort of last attempt there?
Satisfaction. You know, I think that's I don't think I'm unlike a lot of coaches in why I do it, and I'm real happy. I don't want to downplay that, you know, but what we put into it is just for moments like this to have the sense of satisfaction from accomplishment. It's not about cheers or pats on the back. It's just trying to walk out and carry your bag out, throw it on the bus and sit on the bus and say, you know, we did this. We had challenges to overcome, whether it was in preparation or on the field. We came up with the right solutions to those challenges. And then obviously, you know, anybody could see it coming. I could see it coming for days here. Now these kids have been putting a tremendous amount of themselves into this preparation. It's very apparent how important it was to them, and particularly the way they kept fighting back. And just an idea that I'd get it. What I felt good about was the sense of satisfaction, two, the chance that I wouldn't have to console anybody, that I could just put my arm around a bunch of them, particularly those who are leaving, and tell them how much we appreciate what they did for us and that we love them and they're always part of the football family.